Good morning. Today we are going to deal with celestial coordinate systems. We know different type of coordinate system, isn't it? Like a Cartesian coordinate system, spherical polar coordinate system, isn't it? Here in this class, we are going to study about celestial coordinate systems. We know that the position of a place on Earth is defined by two coordinates. Which are they? They are latitude and longitude. So with the help of latitude and longitude, you can determine the position of a place on Earth. Similarly, the position of a heavenly object, a celestial object, can be defined or can be described by knowing its celestial coordinates. So, in this class, we are going to discuss about three different types of celestial coordinate systems. But before moving on to the topic, we have to familiarize with several terms related to this coordinate systems. The first one is celestial sphere. Imagine that you are observing a star. So you are at Earth, and from Earth you are observing a star. So the distance between the observer, that means you, and the star be the radius of a sphere. That means consider the distance between the observer and the star as a radius and draw a sphere. So that in that sphere, the center will be the observer and the star will be on the surface of that sphere, isn't it? So that sphere is known as celestial sphere. So celestial sphere means all bright heavenly bodies are situated at vast distances from us, and they appear to lie on the inner sphere of infinite radius whose center is at observer's eye. So this is the Earth here, isn't it? So you are observing from Earth and think that the star is here. So this is the radius, and you can draw a sphere like this. So this sphere, on this sphere, the center will be the observer from the Earth, and the star will be here, means the star is on the surface of the sphere. So this great sphere is known as celestial sphere. Now think that the observer is here, and you can draw a line from the observer to the celestial sphere. So it will touch the celestial sphere here, and okay, you can also extend the line towards this side also, so that the point will touch the celestial sphere here. So this point that is lying above the observer is known as zenith, and the point lying below the observer on the celestial sphere is called nadir. I repeat, zenith is a point vertically above the observer on the celestial sphere, whereas nadir is a point vertically below the observer on the celestial sphere. So if you can think an observer to be here, so you can extend the line, and this line will touches the celestial sphere here, which is known as zenith, and on the other side it will touches the celestial sphere maybe here, which is known as nadir. Now the next term is a celestial equator. You can see the celestial equator in the picture. You know the Earth's equator, isn't it? So this is the Earth having the north pole above and the south pole below, and having the Earth equator like this. Now we are having a celestial sphere here, and this celestial sphere is also having a celestial equator. How we can define this celestial equator? It is a plane drawn perpendicular to the north-south direction, which cuts the celestial sphere in a great circle. See, this is the north-south direction of the Earth. Perpendicular means this inner circle is perpendicular to the north-south direction of the Earth, and it cuts the celestial sphere in a great circle, and this great circle is known as celestial equator. So now you know the four terms: what is a celestial sphere, what is zenith, nadir, and celestial equator. Now, we are drawing a line through the observer parallel to Earth's rotational axis, and we are extending this line to the celestial sphere so that this line will meet or cut the celestial sphere at two points, which is known as the north celestial pole and south celestial pole. That is, we are extending a line drawn through the observer. See, think that the observer is here. So you can draw the line like this, towards up and towards down. So what happens? This line will cut the celestial sphere here, and the point lying above the celestial sphere, above the celestial sphere, is known as north celestial pole, and below is known as the south celestial pole, which is similar to the north pole and south pole of the Earth. So we are drawing a line through the observer parallel to Earth's rotational axis so that this line will cut the celestial sphere at two points, which is known as the north celestial pole, the point lying above, and the south celestial pole, which is the point lying below, which is similar to the north pole as well as the south pole of the Earth. Now the next term is ecliptic. What is ecliptic? It is the apparent path of the sun in the sky as the Earth revolves around the sun. Here you can see a red circle. So this red circle is the ecliptic, which is a great circle fixed on the celestial sphere. So this is the celestial sphere, the outer sphere is the celestial sphere, and there you can see this great circle on the celestial sphere, and this circle is known as ecliptic. How we can define ecliptic? It is the intersection of the plane of Earth's orbit around the sun with the celestial sphere. I repeat, the Earth is revolving around the sun. So this Earth is having a particular orbit, isn't it? So that plane of Earth's orbit intersects the celestial sphere. And that great circle is known as ecliptic. I repeat, intersection of the plane of Earth's orbit around Sun with the celestial sphere. So in this slide we had seen North Celestial Pole, South Celestial Pole and also ecliptic. Here you can see that this is the celestial equator. The blue circle is the celestial equator, isn't it? And the red great circle is the ecliptic. And there is a small inclination between them. And that angle is 23 degree 27 minutes. That means ecliptic is inclined to the celestial equator by 23 degree 27 minutes. Now we are going to study about vernal equinox and autumnal equinox. What is vernal equinox? Here you can see that this intersection of ecliptic with the celestial equator is known as vernal equinox, whereas the opposite point here is known as the autumnal equinox. I repeat, the ecliptic intersects the celestial equator at a point, and that point is known as vernal equinox, and the opposite point, that is here, this point is known as autumnal equinox. Let's see the definition. Vernal equinox is the point where ecliptic crosses the celestial equator from south to north. When we move from south to north, the ecliptic meets the celestial equator at a point called vernal equinox. And autumnal equinox is the opposite point where the ecliptic crosses the equator from north to south. So moving from north to south, you can see the ecliptic crosses the celestial equator at this point called autumnal equinox. Now, you can see the figure of Earth here, and it is a rotation axis, and here is a north pole, south pole, and equator is here, and the sun's rays are coming towards the Earth. Here you can see that half of the Earth is day and the other half is night, and this is known as equinox. That means on March 21st, Sun reaches at vernal equinox. We had said that here ecliptic is a apparent path of the Sun, isn't it? So the Sun is moving. Sun is having its path at equinox when on March 21st. So on March 21st, Sun reaches at vernal equinox. Or what we can say, that Sun is exactly vertically above the Earth's equator. Vertically above the Earth's equator, so that the Sun's rays fall vertically on equatorial regions, so that the day and night duration are equal. So that this is known as equinox. So the all over the Earth, the day and night duration are equal on March 21st, since the Sun reaches at vernal equinox. And this is known as equinox, which means equal duration of day and night. This is a slide which shows the vernal equinox and autumnal equinox. See, vernal equinox we had seen where the sun reaches the vernal equinox, and here autumnal equinox means the sun having the sun at autumnal equinox. And there are two other points which are known as summer solstice and winter solstice. See here, vernal equinox will be on March 21st or 22nd, where incoming solar energy will be equal in both hemispheres, which we give it the term vernal equinox and autumnal equinox. See, in the case of summer solstice, that is coming on June 21st or 22nd, the incoming solar energy will be greatest in the northern hemisphere. So, in such a situation, we call it as summer solstice. And in the case of winter solstice, that occurs in December 21-22, the incoming solar energy is greatest in southern hemisphere. So that the length of the day is longer than night on the southern hemisphere, and the reverse will happen in the northern hemisphere. So these are the four important terms, that is the vernal equinox, autumnal equinox, summer solstice and winter solstice. Equinox is given for vernal and autumnal because in both the cases the length of day and night are equal, so that they are given the name vernal equinox and autumnal equinox. So, during summer solstice, the incoming solar energy is greater in northern hemisphere. That means the length of the day become longer than night in northern hemisphere. Now, in winter solstice, the incoming solar energy is greater in southern hemisphere. That means the length of the day is longer than night on southern hemisphere. So, that's about the seasonal configuration of Earth and Sun. And this is due to this seasonal configuration is explained due to the movement of Earth around Sun. So, with these terms, we can move on to our main topic, that is celestial coordinate systems. I have already told you that these coordinate systems are used in order to describe or in order to find out the position of a celestial object. We already know the Cartesian coordinate system. So this is the simple Cartesian coordinate system, which is two dimensional, in which a point P is described by its coordinates x and y. So knowing x and y, you can identify the point P. So here we had used the two-dimensional coordinate system, and the coordinates used are x and y in order to identify or in order to describe the point P. Similarly, in order to describe the position of a celestial object, we use different celestial coordinate systems, like a horizontal coordinate system, equatorial coordinate system, ecliptic coordinate system, and the galactic coordinate system. We shall discuss only three among them. There are, first one is horizon system, second one is equatorial system, and third one is ecliptic system. So the first system is horizon system, which is also known as ultra azimuth system, and that is due to the name of its coordinates. Here, the star, position of a star is determined by two coordinates, and the first coordinate is azimuth and the second coordinate is altitude. So that this horizon system is also known as altazimuth system. Altitude and azimuth coordinates are used to describe the position of a star or a celestial object. So that this system is also known as altazimuth system. Now, in the system, we will define a great circle. See here, you can see a circle, a great circle here. So, what is this great circle? How it is formed? See, you can think that the earth is at the center, isn't it? So that we are observing the star from here. So, the plane of earth, see, where will be the plane? Where will be the plane? Here, this is the plane. On extending this plane, it will cut the celestial sphere like this. So, this is the great circle here. Having north point N and south point S. How the great circle is formed? The great circle is formed by the intersection of horizontal plane at a place on the earth with the celestial sphere. So, the outer circle is the celestial sphere, isn't it? And this is the horizontal plane of the earth. Like you can imagine of a ball cutting by its middle. So, the outer surface of the ball is our celestial sphere. And we are cutting the ball at its middle so that it cuts the celestial sphere, isn't it? So, that great circle is known as horizon. And in this horizon, you can take either south point or north point as the origin. We need an origin for the coordinate system, isn't it? From which we can measure the coordinates. So here, N is taken as the origin here. N means the great circle or the horizon which cuts the celestial sphere here. So this point is taken as the origin. And here you can see that a great circle is drawn. This is the upper point from the observer, that is the zenith. This is the lower point, that is the nadir. So you can join this zenith and nadir through this star, touching this star. That means from zenith to nadir, you can draw a circle. And now you can measure the coordinates. See, while drawing, you can see that this will touch the great circle at F, or the horizon at F. So, NF is the first coordinate which is known as the azimuth, measured on the horizon. So this great circle is the horizon and we are measuring NF as angle. So the angle NF measured on the horizon is known as the azimuth A, given as A here. That is the angle measured, which is the first coordinate azimuth. Now, you can see that there is one more coordinate. See, this cuts the horizon at F, and F sigma is known as the altitude represented by small h. So the also this F sigma is measured in angle, and azimuth and altitude are the two coordinates used to specify or identify the position of a star in a horizon system. Or we can use the distance Z sigma here. Z sigma is given as small sigma, which is the zenith distance, which can be calculated by the equation 90 minus h. So that's about the horizon system. See here, the observer is here. This is the celestial equator. The plane of the observer, that means this plane is cutting the celestial sphere in a great circle, and this great circle is known as horizon, and we are observing the star from here, so that from the zenith we are drawing a great circle which cuts the horizon at this point, and the angle NF measured is known as azimuth, and F sigma, sigma is the star, and the angle F sigma is known as the altitude. So with the help of azimuth and altitude, you can determine the position of the star in a horizon system. But there is a disadvantage for this horizon system, because due to the rotation of the earth, this altitude and azimuth changes with the time, so that this system cannot be used for making permanent star charts. So this horizon system can be used only for the quick measurement of the position of a star at a particular time. Since the altitude and azimuth changes with the time, we can make use of this coordinate system only for the quick measurement of the position of a star. So that's about the horizon system. Next is equatorial system. And there are two equatorial systems. One is the local equatorial system, and second one is the universal equatorial system. I repeat, local equatorial system and universal equatorial system. And here we are discussing about the universal equatorial system, which is used for giving fixed coordinates to stars. I had already told you that a horizon system cannot be used for determining the permanent position of stars. But here, universal equatorial system can be used to get the fixed coordinates of the star. Now, here we can see, this is the outer sphere, which is the celestial sphere. This is the celestial north pole, CNP. This is the celestial south pole, CSP. Here we have the celestial equator, which is the intersection of plane of Earth's orbit on the celestial sphere, and here is the ecliptic, and this ecliptic cuts the celestial equator at V, that is the vernal equinox. Now, which is the great circle here? In the last system, we had seen that the great circle is the horizon. In here, the celestial equator is taken as the great circle. And here you can see that the celestial north pole is joined to the celestial south pole through the star Sigma. That means you can join the celestial north pole like this to the celestial south pole. So the star is included here, and this half circle, half of this great circle is known as our circles, H-O-U-R, our circles. So the half circle is known as the our circle here. And here two coordinates which are used in this universal equatorial system are declination and right ascension. Declination is again the angular distance between the star and the equator measured along the hour circle. So the distance, angular distance between the star Sigma and the celestial equator is known as declination. So that F Sigma is known as the declination here. Now the next coordinate is right ascension. How you can measure the right ascension? The distance again measured in angle from vernal equinox to the celestial equator F. So this is the celestial equator, isn't it? So this our circle cuts the celestial equator at F. So that VF is the right ascension here. So declination is F Sigma and right ascension is VF. So the two coordinates are declination, which is the angular distance measured from F to the star, and the right ascension is the angular distance measured from vernal equinox V to the celestial equator F. So these are the two coordinates which are used in the universal equatorial system, and here vernal equinox is the considered as the origin of this coordinate system. So the origin of the coordinate system is here at the vernal equinox. In the horizon system we consider the northern point and south point was there, and north point was considered as the origin. Here vernal equinox V is considered as the origin here. Here you can see that here we are measuring the star. So this is the declination, that is the angular distance showed in red color is the declination, and from vernal equinox to this point is known as the right ascension. That is the again the angular distance. Now the next last system is ecliptic system. Here ecliptic is considered as the great circle, and again vernal equinox is the origin of the coordinate system. So this is the ecliptic circle, and it is considered as the great circle here, and here the ecliptic cuts the celestial equator at this point called the vernal equinox, which is considered as the origin of the coordinate system. And here again this is the ecliptic path, isn't it? So ecliptic is having its north pole and south pole here, so that The north pole is known as ecliptic north pole and the south pole is known as ecliptic south pole. And you can join the ecliptic north pole and ecliptic south pole through the star. So that VF, V is the vernal equinox and F is the point obtained while we are drawing the hour circle from north pole to south pole. It cuts the ecliptic at this point. So VF is known as the celestial longitude and F sigma is known as celestial latitude. The distance measured from the origin, here the origin is vernal equinox. So the distance measured from the origin V or vernal equinox in angle to the point F. So this is the angular distance VF, which is known as the celestial longitude. And the distance from F to sigma in angle is known as the celestial longitude. So that the angular distance from F to sigma is known as celestial latitude. See, both are given as a celestial longitude here. It's not right. VF is the celestial longitude and F sigma is the celestial latitude. See, again here you can see the earth is here. From we are measuring the, observing the star. So that this is latitude and this is longitude. So the vernal equinox is here. See, the celestial equator is in red color and the ecliptic is in blue color and it gets meet at this point, which is vernal equinox. So this is the origin from which we are measuring the longitude towards this point. So that is the celestial longitude. And from here to here, the angular distance measured is known as celestial latitude. So in ecliptic system, the coordinates used are celestial longitude and celestial latitude. So that's about the three celestial coordinate system. First one was horizon system or alta azimuth system, in which the coordinates used to describe the position of a star was altitude and azimuth. In universal equatorial system, we used the coordinates declination and right ascension. And the last one, in the ecliptic system, we used the coordinates celestial latitude and celestial longitude. Now let's move on to our last topic, constellation. What do you mean by constellation? Constellation are a group of stars that form a particular pattern in the sky. Group of stars that forms a particular pattern in the sky, and the shapes you see all depend on your point of view. So the shape depends on the observer. So that the stars in the constellation are not close to each other. We think that the stars are close to each other, but they are not, because they are viewed from Earth, which is very fast distance from us. So, but viewed from Earth, they can be seen to be grouped together. So, constellations are the group of stars that forms a particular pattern in the sky, and we can name this these constellations according to the shape they have. And here you can see there are 88 total constellations, and they are named on big Greek and Babylonian rulers of 15th century. And every constellation has a story of how they came to be and what they mean to represent. So the constellations are given the name according to the shape they have, and one of the constellation has the planet Mars in between. So the Mars is there in one of the constellation. See, this is a group of star, isn't it? And there are brightest star as well as faintest star in this group. And joining these stars, you can see it forms a shape of a snake. So this constellation is named as Hydra, which is the largest constellation in the sky, which is also known as Sea Serpent. So it represents a giant water snake. So Hydra is the longest or the largest constellation in the sky. See, here you can see four stars, isn't it? So joining the four stars, you can see it's a shape of a cross. So this constellation containing this four stars is given the name Crux. Crux means cross. So Crux is the shortest constellation. So the longest constellation is Hydra, which means a snake, and the shortest one is Crux, which means cross. See, this is another constellation. See, so joining these stars, it forms a shape of a dog. So this is Canis Major. And this type of constellation atlas was prepared by German astrophysicist Bayer. He was the first who prepared this constellation atlas. And here you can see this, that in this Canis Major constellation, there is a brightest star. So he named this brightest star as Alpha Canis Majoris. And the second brightest, which will be the second brightest? Maybe this one, isn't it? So the second brightest one is given as Beta Canis Majoris, and the following with a Gamma, Delta, etc. So that is another example for constellation. And the constellation name is Canis Major, that means a big dog constellation. And all constellations are different in sizes, and also they are given the Greek or Roman names in order to identify them with their shapes. So that's about constellations. Thank you.